Welcome to Green and Red, scrappy politics for scrappy people, a regular podcast on radical environmental and anti-capitalist politics, brought to you by Bob Bazanko and Scott Park.
Welcome to the silky smooth sounds of the Green and Red podcast. I'm your co-host, Scott Parkin, in Berkeley, California today. Unfortunately, Bob is out today. He's off on assignment, but he'll be rejoining us soon. So I'm going to take over the whole flow show, show intro where Bob and I split it. But first of all, we want to thank all of our audience for listening to the Green and Red podcast. Those numbers have been steadily growing, and so much of love and appreciation, and a big shout out to all of our new listeners that have been joining us lately. Definitely if you wanna check us out on our social media channels, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and then also if you're watching this on YouTube or you're listening to us on a podcast platform, but watch YouTube, please subscribe to us on our YouTube page. Then also if you like what you are hearing, you can become a donor to the Green and Red podcast, and you can go to greenandredpodcast.org and hit that support button. And we're actually going to be having a new website going live pretty soon, and so you should definitely be checking that out. And then also you can go to our Patreon page and become a patron of Green and Red podcast at patreon.com/greenandredpodcast. But definitely check us out. And then today we are going to be talking about an issue that's been in the news quite a bit lately, which are the right-wing trucker blockades going on in Ottawa, happening on the Ambassador Bridge and other points of border points between the U.S. and Canada. We're going to be talking about all of this and the politics of it. We're going to be talking with Roberta Lexier, who is a professor at Mount Royal University in Calgary. Roberta, welcome to Green and Red.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm excited to do this.
Yep. Roberta is an associate professor in the Department of General Education and Department of Humanities at Mount Royal. She also works with a couple of podcasts in Canada. One is called Informed Opinions, the Alberta Advantage podcast, and the Forgotten Corners podcast. And she's also on the board of directors of the Harbinger Media Network. So maybe just to kind of like kick it off, could you actually just maybe start with a little bit of a background of what's happening, what the situation has been? Then we'll kind of go into some more specific questions.
Yeah, that sounds great. I'd love to hear from you also about what you've been hearing down in the US and how it's being covered down there. So basically what happened is that a couple of weeks ago, a group of quote truckers started a quote convoy from Western Canada to the capital in Ottawa. And I put these words in quotation marks, and we'll get into some of the complexity of this movement in a bit. But basically a couple of weeks ago, a bunch of people got in a bunch of vehicles and started a convoy from Vancouver all the way across to Ottawa. And they held a big sort of rally there, I guess, kind of have taken over the city of Ottawa or the downtown area, Parliament Hill. They've been holding sort of daily events and rallies. They have this thing they do. Their big tactic is horn honking. So kind of 24/7 for the first little while, they'd just be honking their horns all day and night. And they've basically been kind of occupying the downtown Parliament Hill area of Ottawa. And then at the borders in many of the provinces, Alberta, Saskatchewan, Manitoba, and then you mentioned the Ambassador Bridge between Windsor and Detroit, there's been sort of convoys of trucks that have shut down those border points for, depending which one, for different amounts of time. And so, you know, it's actually a pretty big thing that's happening. It's, relatively large numbers kind of happening across the country. And it's really wacky.
It's led to Trudeau to declare a state of emergency the other day, right? like yesterday.
Yeah, so I think it was yesterday. Yeah, days are lost in a pandemic, but I think it was yesterday they declared the Emergencies Act. And interestingly, I mean, this act has never been used before. It was kind of created post 1970 October crisis in Canada, which was kind of our only terrorist attack that's ever happened on Canadian soil. What, again, in quotation marks, terrorist, however you define that. And at that time, we only had what was known as the War Measures Act, and it was invoked to basically shut down this, this separatist ring. And that was proven so problematic that they decided to change the legislation so that it's a little bit more limited in what kinds of civil liberties they can squash, but basically it gives kind of extraordinary powers to the government to try and stop this, these protests or whatever we want to call them.
And this is because, like, another news story that we heard earlier in the week or late last week was that the blockades at the border crossings, one of which was a pretty busy one, were causing supply chain issues between the U.S. and Canada. The Biden administration was complaining to Trudeau, et cetera.
Yeah, so this is the funny thing about this conversation is that when all of this first started, maybe, I don't know, time again has no meaning, but 3 weeks ago, I want to say, there was an explosion of conversations around supply chain. This was like the huge issue that everything was disrupting the supply chain. We need to get rid of vaccine mandates to fix supply chain issues. This was the big argument. And so this convoy sort of used rhetoric that was about ending vaccine mandates. Basically arguing that because there's a vaccine mandate to cross the border into Canada or to cross the border into the United States, it was basically limiting the amount of supplies that could come across the borders. But within maybe a day or two, maybe 3 days, that conversation completely stopped. It was no longer about supply chains at all. And in part, that was because one of their tactics was to block these border crossings, which actually did disrupt supply chains. Vaccine mandates were not disrupting supply chains. Most of the drivers are vaccinated and moving across the border, but the blockades that they started to try and protest those vaccines did end up messing with supply chains, and so they stopped talking about supply chains and started talking about other things.
I heard a stat the other day that it's only 10% of Canadian truckers that are unvaccinated, where in the U.S. it's like 40%.
Oh, interesting. Yeah, I mean, this is the interesting part, is that it was claimed to be a trucker protest, that these were truckers upset about the mandate. But yeah, as you say, 90% of truckers in the industry are vaccinated. The other question was always, you know, first of all, most of this legislation is provincial in our case. The provinces set health policy in Canada. But also, you know, the American government has a vaccine mandate in place as well. And so, you know, if Canada somehow got rid of our vaccine mandate, it wasn't going to change anything about that cross-border shipment, because you'd still have to be vaccinated to get into the U.S. So, I mean, it in my opinion, and I think it's showing fruit that I mean, this is all an excuse to rally the forces together and to demonstrate some support for a very fringe that's growing ideology, I think.
You know, I travel in a lot of organizing circles, left organizing circles, a lot of environmentalists, but also social justice folks who have, many of them see this as a sort of like Canadian January 6th sort of moment, which is where, you know, the truckers backed by wealthy donors, probably from the US, are just using it as an opportunity to stick it to like the liberal ruling class, to stick it to Trudeau. And I would say, is that one of the main points here? Is that why this is all happening?
Yeah, I mean, I think so. My sense is that, you know, this is being framed as a working class protest by truckers who are opposed to a vaccine mandate. And nothing shows the evidence that that's the case. As we already talked about, you know, most truckers are vaccinated and working just fine. We now have lists of donors that were basically released through hacking, I believe. Somehow these were released. And so we know who was funding this convoy. And it's, as you say, large wealthy donors, about 40%, it's estimated, were from the US. And so there's like a real foreign funded element to this. And you know, I do want to emphasize that Canada has its own You know, we have our own national white supremacist, fascist problems. People will tend to blame this on the US and say, you know, like the US's problems are now bleeding across our border. But the reality is these are homegrown problems that in fact, a lot of the white supremacists and others in the US are imports from the from Canada. You know, Proud Boys were Canadian to start with. And so, you know, I don't want to say this is a US driven thing, but I do think we have to acknowledge the foreign funded part of this. And I think more importantly, the kind of connection to the larger movement that seems to be happening in the US, and I would say, I think globally we're seeing as well, where, you know, we're seeing a real decline in people's material conditions through, you know, a global pandemic, a climate crisis, a crisis of capitalism more broadly. And people who have been organizing on the right and the white supremacist circles and the fascist circles for a long time are using this decline in material conditions to pull in supporters and pull in or to grow their movement. And so a couple of years ago, this took the form of the Yellow Vest movement in Canada, which was this weird adaptation of the Yellow Vest movement in France, which actually was working class and fighting for the working class. In our case, it was these like petty bourgeoisie oil, like the petrochemical industry basically is funding most of this, and really trying to draw in support for this movement that's really pushing against any potential changes to the capitalist system. And so I think we're seeing, like January 6th, I would argue was and Trump is an expression of that decline of material conditions that people are angry and upset, legitimately so. It's being directed into the wrong places, and they're just taking advantage of it, I think, for these movements.
Yeah, Bob often calls the folks who showed up on January 6th as the lumpen oligarchy, which are are folks who are like probably like culturally like very working class, but you know, materially are actually more well off. Like, you know, there's stories of people flying to the January 6th on private jets and things like that. Speaking about the Yellow Vests, just to go back to that for a second, which in France is like has very much like anti-capitalist elements to it, which we're not really seeing here. But there have been actually previous freedom convoys or truck convoys that were, there wasn't one of them actually called the Yellow Vest convoy, like in previous years?
Yeah, so these Yellow Vesters, I want to say, I don't know, maybe are we talking 2019? I want to say, I feel like it was pre-pandemic, but again, time is so weird these days. I'm a historian. I should probably start figuring out the timing of things. But yeah, so these kind of local groups started to emerge in protest, or they were using the carbon tax that Justin Trudeau and the Liberals were putting in place as an excuse to protest. So again, I think like using vaccine mandates to rally these forces together. In that case, they were using carbon taxes and kind of this attack on the oil and gas sector. And so, you know, in France, the Yellow Vesters kind of emerged around these similar issues, but it was in fact that the onus for paying these taxes and for covering the cost of environmental degradation was being borne by the working class rather than the wealthy. That's what they were doing in France. But here, you know, similar, as I said, to now, it was being used by this group who are trying to protect a particular industry to start rallying people together. And they have now these are the same people really who have shifted into this larger mass movement.
Just, you know, talking about some of those folks who are supporting this, particularly in Canada, you know, coming out of the oil industry, which is, you know, Alberta, which is where you're from, I'm originally from Texas, and Alberta is often referred to as the Texas of Canada, and Texas is referred to as the Alberta of the US, and at least by me. You know, it's kind of interesting that, you know, this is driven by the oil industry. And a question I had for you later, but I'll talk about it right now, is that we've actually seen the police have been fairly sympathetic to these protests in Ottawa. I believe the Ottawa police chief stepped down or got sacked just yesterday over his handling of this. But it's also interesting that we see the way in which the police, the Royal Canadian Mounted Police, actually respond to like land defenders, First Nations land defenders, particularly in Western Canada. I see a lot of it around the Unistoten camp and stuff like that. If you have any thoughts on that?
Oh, I have so many thoughts on that. I mean, this is one of the big pieces that's come out of this convoy since it started, is that, you know, the way the provincial and local police, and then also our national police, which is the RCMP, have responded to Ottawa, the convoy and the occupation of Ottawa, and then also these border crossings, the occupations or blockades of border crossings, has been, I'm not even sure what word to use. I mean, they're basically just supporting the protests. They're joining them.
High fives.
Yeah, there was a great video. And by great, I mean, I want to vomit watching it. But there's this video of when they cleared the border here in Alberta at Coutts. There was, you know, the police are caught on video hugging the protesters and thanking them for what they were doing. And they just yesterday found a cache of weapons with that group of that blockade. 11 people were arrested. Some of them have been charged with attempted murder. Like, this is a big thing. Like, this is possibly an attempt at an insurrection or a coup of the country. And the police force is basically just hanging out and seeing them as their buddies. And we can talk about why that might be. But before I do that, I'll say, you know, as you say, in contrast to that, in Canada, we've had a lot of examples over the last few years, but also over the decades, of how police will treat Indigenous folks in particular, but also anybody in the BIPOC community, the LGBTQ community, anybody in the sort of marginalized communities. You know, you mentioned Wet'suwet'en. We also have, there was blockades happening 2 years ago now around the building of pipelines. There's been occupations in Quebec and all over the country. And those are, you know, attacked with full force. The RCMP had, you know, they were allowed to use lethal force to clear out a blockade isn't even the right word of a pipeline construction project. And so, you know, for a lot of people, it's been this real, I think, funny enough, for those of us who are aware of these issues, it's been a real eye opener for them to see it really laid out so clearly how differently the police will respond to one group versus another group. And, you know, then the response is, well, why don't they just police these people? And so then the debate has to be, well, no, we don't want police for any of this stuff. Like, the police aren't the answer to a right-wing convoy, just as they're not the answer to, you know, Indigenous protests. And so that then becomes part of this debate. And it's, you know, it's rich. There's lots going on.
Yeah. And we have very similar debates here.
Of course. And I think, you know, your police forces are similar to ours in that, you know, we have to remember that the whole reason that the RCMP, or at that point they were called the Northwest Mounted Police, were created was to clear the plains for white settlement and to protect the expansion of capitalism throughout Canada and then around the world. And so, of course, their response to Indigenous folks is going to be a very particularly harsh one, because that's exactly why they exist for 150 years. That's why they've existed, is to put down that group of people particularly. And the same in the US, right? Like, your police force is largely created to clear the plains, but also to deal with African Americans escaping from slavery and that sort of building of your legal system. And so, of course, that's built in. Same with the private property thing. You know, they will, you know, I remember back in 99 throwing things at Starbucks and people getting arrested for that. Of course, that's a big deal. But if you're, you know, I don't know, occupying the central city of a country, it's apparently not. So there's some interesting dynamics. And I think they're very similar in the two countries because of that settler colonial and capitalist history. We have so much of that built right into those systems.
I always like to think that half the occupiers are probably off-duty cops anyway, or retired cops.
Absolutely. We've had two Edmonton police were suspended today, pending investigation, for being involved. You know, there are just two that got caught. You know, I guarantee there's many, many in there. And this is part of the problem. Like, the cops aren't going to be the solution. They are these people, you know, they are part of these groups.
Yeah, I mean, I remember on January 6th watching everything play out, and I'm like, I bet there are so many active duty military in that crowd and off-duty police who traveled there. And lo and behold, so many people who have been getting arrested, getting, you know, sanctioned at work or even fired, thankfully, you know, are all on the police force. And so it's not at this point, it's just, maybe I've just been around too long, but it's just like getting old, but it's just like, it's not a surprise anymore at this point.
No, I mean, it's laid bare for us to see so much. And I think, you know, you say the ones that are actively involved, but there's also the ones that'll just ignore what's happening, right? Like, they may not have joined the convoy, but they can't imagine, there's nothing within them that can imagine somehow turning their forces against somebody who looks like them and who isn't seen as a threat. Like, we're trained in our society to see people of color as an automatic threat, and they don't see these white middle-aged men as a threat because they are the same people. And, you know, so I think even if they're not actively supporting the movements, they are still not able to see them in the same light as the other Indigenous and other movements.
Talking about another component of the far right, you know, there's a lot of stories about how a lot of these trucks, some of them are even flying like Confederate flags and Nazi flags. And you were talking earlier about, you know, we're seeing this rise of a far right, white supremacist far right globally, definitely seeing it here in the US. And I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about that in regards to the convoy.
Yeah, absolutely. And again, this is sparked a huge conversation in Canada. And as I said before, the temptation here is always to just blame it on the US and say, you know, it's being imported or whatever's happening there is happening here and we better stop it. This isn't the Canadian way. You know, we Canadians are nice and peaceful and we don't do this kind of stuff. And, you know, as I said before, that's crap. I mean, all of that's a lie. We're built on this basis of white supremacist colonialism. And so, you know, people will argue that that's a small part of the group that are involved, that, you know, there were at the first rally that happened in Ottawa that first weekend, there were tons of swastikas and Confederate flags and, you know, all sorts of disgusting emblems and symbols. And people at the time said, well, that's just a small number of people who just showed up to this thing. You can't control who shows up to a protest. And I mean, I've been around the block. I've been to many, many protests, and not once has there been a swastika there that was on my side anyway. There was sometimes on the other side, but like, if Nazis are showing up at your protest, there's something going on there. So I'll say that to that argument. But also, I think it's important to acknowledge that the people organizing this are involved in white supremacist organizing, especially in Alberta. There is a very active Aryan Nations and other, like, there's multiple groups, but lots of white supremacists around here, not surprisingly, in a settler colonial area that was cleared for white settlement. And they are the ones organizing this. So the veneer is being put on it that it's this, you know, working class movement, but it's really a pushback against working class people and working class movements. And it is tied, I think, to the larger global picture of what's happening, that, you know, the same issues that are happening in the US and happening around the world are happening in Canada as well. And these, as I said earlier, the material conditions are declining. So of course, people are looking for answers, and this is where they're turning. And I think in a lot of the rhetoric, you can see how you know, how integrated white supremacy is into this movement, that so much of it is about, you know, taking Canada back. And, you know, they use the 14 words all the time about, like, making sure we repopulate the white population. They, you know, they're tapping into the same kind of exclusionary language that we would hear elsewhere. And, you know, the anti-Semitism's all over the place. And yeah, I think it's pretty obvious that it's at the core of what's going on here, despite whatever veneer they want to put on it.
Would you say that this is a reaction that the, you know, these far right organizers, which are somewhat marginalized, are taken advantage of? Or would you say that we're also looking at, or would you say that we're looking at some sort of emergent political movement? And sometimes go ahead.
No, that's okay. I think it's probably a little bit of both, that there's, you know, an attempt by these right-wing organizers to take advantage of a moment. And I might say, I wish the left would do this a little bit more right now, that we would take advantage of this moment like they are, but that's a different conversation we could have. But I think, you know, part of it's that there's this kind of group that's been working for a very long time. And it's, you know, it's, it, it's now they have this opportunity to kind of rally the troops together. But that said, I think it's fair to say that we are seeing the emergence of a global fascist movement that's really gaining steam and gaining support. And a lot of that has to do with the crisis conditions that we're in. You know, when capitalism goes into crisis, the only way to save it at this point is to create these kind of exclusionary, hyper-national, hyper-masculine, hyper-violent movements to try and rescue it. And so it doesn't surprise me that it's rising. But I think we have to recognize that this is what's going on. It's happening around the world. And that this is, I think, an expression of that. And I think a terrifying one in the sense of how big it actually is getting and that it's kind of lingering on. And, you know, this is not going away in any quick fashion.
Yeah, it's very disturbing, Howard. It's, you know, Hungary, you know, Northern Europe, Central Europe, Australia, US and Canada. I personally feel like that maybe this is just from being in the vantage point or from being in the US, but I feel like Trump somehow has like fueled it. That at least in the US, it feels like it's like just really sort of kind of coming off the rails, and partially was it the Trump presidency for 4 years
where he supported
that stuff.
Absolutely. And I think, you know, obviously it doesn't start with Trump because Trump gets elected because that stuff's happening already in the background. But what I think Trump does, and this is where it gets scary to me about how we platform a lot of this, is that Trump makes it okay. He makes it politically in some ways acceptable to be saying such things on a global scale without pushback. And, that's what concerns me. I've been saying that for years around, the organization of the People's Party of Canada, which is a very, very right-wing fringe political party. It was like the worst of the conservatives splintered off. And, you know, people want them to be invited to debates and such because they think that's democracy. You know, we got to air all the issues and we got to debate them out in a legitimate fashion. But I actually think what's happened is we've just platformed these ideas so much and we've normalized them. You know, we're making it so that that's an okay thing to say in the public, that, you know, Mexicans are to blame for our economic problems. Like, no.
Or violent riots at the U.S. Capitol are legitimate political discourse.
Like, right, exactly.
That's normalizing something I never thought I would see.
No, absolutely. And I'm like honestly legitimately terrified about the state that we're in right now, because I think, as I said before, you know, nobody's offering another alternative to the situation. I mean, obviously we are, people are, you are, we're all trying on the left to kind of insert some sort of alternatives here, but when there's not really a large left presence to say, yeah, we get it. Life is really crappy. And you know what? You know, the transition from fossil fuels is going to be hard and it is going to suck for you that you're going to lose your job. But there's ways that we can address that and make sure we all survive and we all thrive and flourish. But because we're not offering those, or those aren't getting through in the mainstream, they're not, you know, anything solid. This right is just rising so fast and tapping into those real concerns people have.
Well, it's in regards to that, but a lack of a response from the left. It's to me, it seems very much like we've seen the state and the liberal state, little L liberal state, you know, wage war on the left for a long time. And I can, you know, 100 years in the US, probably much longer than that, but like really thinking back 100 years. And it's, you know, and the media, the corporate media is complicit in it. It's like left voices are drowned out and movements are infiltrated and attacked and discredited. Whereas like they've allowed the right, in the US, I feel like they're focusing a little bit more on the right, the far right groups now. But like I feel like the liberal state, even within the Democratic Party itself, only knows how to punch left.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. And absolutely. And I think it's being laid bare. And that's why I'm scared, because, you know, any left resistance is going to be squashed, whereas this gets airtime, it gets a lot of support and a lot of positions. And I think, you know, it's really interesting, because if we think about the history of fascism, it's really about countering communism, right? It's like, how do we stop these communists from organizing the working class to overthrow this capitalist system? But we don't really have many of those left anymore, because as you said, there's been, you know, a decades, centuries long fight against to weed out anti-capitalists of various sorts. And so it seems to me that this fascist movement is having to kind of create these weird demons in a different sort of way. So the example I've been using is Justin Trudeau himself, where he's become this obsessive figure for this right wing group in Canada. Like, they are unreal obsessed with Justin Trudeau. It's very strange and very unhealthy. And there's this big rumor, it's kind of like the QAnon garbage, but there's this big, very popular rumor that because Justin Trudeau's father, Pierre, was close friends with Fidel Castro, they weren't actually good friends, they just met a couple of times, but they were good friends. And so the argument is that Fidel Castro is actually Justin Trudeau's dad, that he and his mom had an affair, and his dad is Fidel Castro. And it's obviously ridiculous. It's the most outrageous thing. But my sense is it's a way for them to tie him to some sort of communism. This idea of, you know, Justin Trudeau is not a communist. He is not even particularly left liberal. Like, these are ruling class elites. They give away all sorts of corporate welfare. They are the neoliberals, without a doubt. He puts a nice smiley face on it, but he is no better than any of the other ones. And but they have to find a way to discredit him. And but because he's part of their class of people, how do you discredit him? So they've turned him into this weird kid of a communist. Like, it's all just very bonkers. But that's, I think, an indication of how much this is about a right-wing fascist movement emerging to challenge that structure.
I'm kind of curious about what's the right-wing media landscape like in Canada? I mean, we have big corporations fueling that stuff and fueling the misinformation. I'd be kind of curious to hear about that.
Yeah, I mean, we have a similar thing. So one thing I should say is that our mainstream media is fairly right of this on the spectrum, which is the same for you. You know, it's corporate owned. You know, there's no voice for left or other critiques within the mainstream media. But also over the last number of years, we've had an explosion, I'd say, of kind of the right wing media sphere. And Rebel News is sort of our most well known. Ezra Levant is their kind of guru guy, the Steve Bannon of Canada, I guess, in some ways. And they've kind of, you know, they've been the ones stoking a lot of this fuel. They're really on top of a lot of this. And there's a few others like them. And then there's kind of, you know, the same sort of independent right-wing media punditry that you guys have down there. It's also up here, like the Jordan Petersons and the, you know, the Faith Goldies, all the kind of weird, I don't understand them people.
Yeah, who come out and just say random weird shit all the time.
Exactly.
To kind of talking about the more mainstream right, you know, the Conservative Party, which is in some way the your version of the Republican Party. You know, are they like, it's Doug Ford, who I've thought of as Canada's Trump, maybe I'm wrong, is opposed to this, is that right?
To the Convoy? I mean, so I don't know. I mean, Doug Ford is a conservative. He's a neoliberal. His daughter is an anti-vaxxer and very publicly anti-vax. He basically just kept his mouth shut for the whole time. He kind of just didn't say anything. Eventually, he ended up having to kind of take some action and open up borders and such just before the federal government stepped in. But I mean, I'd say he kept quiet because he's not opposed to it. But the Conservative Party in Canada is, I would say, a bit of a, I don't know, to say it's simply a shit show at the moment. So they are sort of the equivalent of your Republican Party, but there's kind of a long, weird history of the party. They used to be the Progressive Conservatives. And so we called them like Red Tories. They were kind of, traditionalists, but good on human rights kind of things. Like, they were, you know, economically conservative, but socially liberal. And we all know that's problematic on all sorts of levels. You can't be one without the other. But they tended to not be like neoliberals. They were kind of old school conservatives. And then in the 90s, there was a real split within the Conservative Party that out of the West in particular arose this group of of real neoliberals. Stephen Harper, who eventually became prime minister for quite some time, he was kind of their leader. Our current premier in Alberta, Jason Kenney, is part of that group. And they were really, at the time, they were the Reform Party, and they were really kind of trying to challenge the conservatives and push them in a different direction, and were very successful. Eventually, they all kind of merged back together into one conservative party. And that's kind of where they're at now, is that within that party, there's kind of multiple strains of right-wing conservatism kind of vying for control. And, you know, there seem to be the group that kind of, a very small group that kind of want to hold on to that kind of progressive conservative thing where, you know, they want to be good for the economy, but they don't want to be overt racists or whatever, you know, that kind of economic thing. But then there's, you know, a large group that are kind of being pulled in this direction, that see this as their path to electoral success, I think. They've been kind of on the margins for a little while now, and this is their way of trying to get to the political center. And I think, again, it's similar, though plays out differently, but similar to the US with what happened with the Tea Party, and now whatever the heck's happening with some of the people you guys have. But we have a similar thing where there's kind of a mix of weirdos all kind of shoved together in this party. And so I think what happened with this convoy is that this then kind of exposed some of those cracks within the Conservative Party, that the leader that they had at the time, Aaron O'Toole, when this started, he was kind of wishy-washy about it. He didn't condemn them, but he didn't say like, rah, rah, go for it. This is great. Yay, freedom. And people took great umbrage with that and were very upset. And so he has now been replaced as leader of the Conservative Party, which happened by a vote of the caucus. So the representatives, not of the party itself. So that may backfire later on at some point, but who knows? So he's now been replaced by Candace Bergen, not Murphy Brown Candace Bergen, but our Candace Bergen, who, if you do a Google search of her, one of the first images that'll pop up is her in a camo MAGA hat. She is well known to be a Trump supporter and kind of on that fringe of our politics. And so she was very supportive of the convoy. She said, yay, freedom, you know, let's go, let's go. But then, you know, I think it was Monday, maybe, or maybe late last week, she was said, you know, your work here is done. You've done what you needed to do. Let us take it over from here and we'll do the work within Parliament. So kind of trying to kind of pull back a little bit. So we'll see what happens with her, and we'll see what happens, I guess, longer term with whoever they pick as their long-term leader. They're a mess, and they may splinter, and yet somehow they can unite together too.
I saw pictures of her eating pizza, I think, with truckers in the streets of Ottawa. But then she's also like an interim leader.
Yeah, so she just took over for now.
Yeah, and she can't become the leader because she's been interim leader or something.
Right. Usually, it's not always the case, but usually if you become interim, you agree to not put your name forward to be the full-time person. So they'll replace her with somebody. But then the question is, who's she going to get replaced with? And we'll see.
My last couple of questions are going to be around the left, and how are the different institutions of the left responding? What are unions doing? I know I've heard some other interviews of kind of more anti-fascist anarchist organizers in Ottawa going out and doing stuff. I've also heard stories about truckers harassing people of color and, you know, other folks in the downtown area. I'm just kind of curious how the left has been responding.
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, the first thing I'll say is that the left is, as we've already talked about, very marginalized and small and fractured and, you know, has all sorts of issues trying to mobilize and for various reasons. And so to a large extent, I would say the institutional left, whatever that is, even if that exists, unions and others, have been pretty quiet to a certain extent. I mean, kind of condemning the racism, of course, the use of Confederate flags, the the kind of overt fascism that we might be seeing, but their response has been kind of like the New Democratic Party, which is, you know, seen as our left party, but they're really not. They're quite centrist. But they called for bigger police presence, you know, better supports to small businesses to help them out. They said, you know, law and order, we got to get the borders back open. Their focus was on the economy. And so, you know, there's been a lot of silence, I would say, around the real issues at the core of this. And I think part of that is a fear of, and I think we saw the same thing happen after 9/11. There's a fear of saying what's actually happening here to sound like we're justifying the actions that are happening, right? Like when people after 9/11 tried to say like, well, why are people bombing the United States? People would say, well, you're just supporting the terrorists. And I think to a certain extent that's happening now, where it's, we can't even really look at what they're doing because we might be supporting them. So I think some of that's been happening. I also think that then what we've seen occur is more local targeted organizing that's starting to develop, these kind of counter protests that are emerging in different sorts of ways in different contexts. And I know you're going to have a long conversation about the one in Ottawa on the weekend, so I won't talk too much about that one. But you know, in other places around the country, similar things happened where you know, people, small groups, got together and blocked the convoy from coming into town, or starting to try and kind of block off their streets and kind of take them back. There's sort of this rhetoric of like, these are our streets and we need to take them back, which I think we need to watch that language a little bit, just in the sense that, you know, we stole these streets to start with. And if anybody's going to claim these streets, they're the Indigenous peoples who originated here. But I think the point is a good point, which is that, you know, the people are not allowed in our spaces. And if the police aren't going to do the work, which obviously they're not, and nor do we want them to necessarily, then it's going to be, the onus is going to be on average people to make the change. And I think we're seeing it develop, and I'm intrigued to see how it evolves over the next couple of weeks as people can start to spend the time organizing and figuring it out. Because, you know, on the left, like, it's one thing for the right to just kind of call out for a big event to happen, like, come all, let's all meet in Ottawa and we'll scream and yell for 3 days and we don't need to plan anything. But the left can't do that, because the left is going to face state repression. The left is going to, you know, face agent provocateurs within its ranks. It's going to, you know, there's all sorts of reasons why the left can't do this.
We'll have the liberals saying that you're going too far, that sort of thing.
Exactly. Let us do our thing in the office and we'll take care of it.
Which sounds like what Candace Bergen is doing to the truckers now.
Exactly.
And I actually, it's interesting in the US, the other place where we saw in the last couple of years, I mean, we saw these big uprisings here in 2020, but then we also, right before the 2020 uprisings, where we saw the left really sort of step in, lean into the sort of left organizing. It was around mutual aid networks around the pandemic, which actually sounds a little bit like what's happening, you know, around this convoy. My final question is going to be another interesting dynamic I've noted, like, sort of happening around the world, is that when we see these sort of far right manifestations happening, where they're even backed by parts of the private sector, and often like oil industry is one of the main backers of this. But then we see other sectors of, you know, the private sector, you know, they actually become more vocal about this in the institutional left and the sort of like left liberal politicians. And I'm wondering, are we seeing, you know, corporations who are some maybe being affected by the supply chain, some of which have like adopted these, like, you know, this is a big thing in corporate America down here, is like social justice purpose. And so have we been seeing actually those entities speak out more?
No, and I'm not sure I want them to, if that's what they're saying down there, is that kind of thing. Yeah. But not really. I mean,
I actually find it very troubling, just to put it out there.
Absolutely. That's what I'm saying. Like, I guess I appreciate that they're paying attention or something, but that's just gross, as you agree, obviously, with that. So what I think we saw is that, you know, a lot of the corporate leaders in Canada are funding a lot of this work, the Convoy and others. We did see some speak out, like some of the trucking companies, for instance, were pretty good at the beginning of saying, like, this is ridiculous. Like, any of our people who are actually participating in this are going to be fired. They're going to lose their license. Like, we will go after people. They just didn't want to be associated with this movement. And I think that makes sense. You know, of course, they don't want to get tarnished with this brush. And then I think we saw a few of the kind of smaller, the kind of in between, the not the big corporate leaders, but the and not the small business owners, but the kind of lumpen proletariat or whatever we want to call them. They started to say, like, okay, we appreciate your calls for freedom, but we need to make sure goods are getting across the border. So maybe it's time to go home. Like, that was kind of their response to it. There hasn't been, as far as I've seen, no real public push by any of the big corporations that I can see to sort of check some of this rising fascism that's happening, right, and say, you know, maybe we should be concerned about this too. And part of that might be the structure of the Canadian economy that, you know, many of our corporations are American owned or multinational. Many of our locally owned corporations are mining and extraction companies. And so they engage in this kind of behavior all over the world. They benefit from freedom, whatever that is. You know, there's not a lot of corporate leaders in this country that are kind of consumer capitalists, like in the US, where they have to worry about their brand in the same sense. And so I wonder if that's limiting it a little bit. I know there was some talk, you know, people have been trying to keep track of the names on trucks, for instance, to start boycotts and other things, and also trying to bring people up on licensing charges and get at them through insurance and other possible ways. Now that's a little bit different with the Emergencies Act that's been declared, but that's kind of taken care of. But also, like, people keeping track of the companies that are kind of letting the Convoy in, I guess, like a Holiday Inn, let them all stay there in Ottawa. So people are like, maybe we should boycott the Holiday Inn. Like, there's been an attempt to kind of keep track of that. And so I think businesses are starting to get a little more wary about whether they're getting connected to this or not. I just haven't seen any realization yet on their part that this is actually something they might want to worry about and that we should think about in a bigger sense.
Probably if they went to Toronto, block the financial district, probably would raise a lot more eyebrows. But I mean,
it might change things.
That, like, the financial sector, Wall Street, is actually who we saw denouncing Trump with the Stop the Steal and with the Capitol insurrection. I mean, they were outright calling for the 25th Amendment. It was a big thing that we covered back then. It's a big part of our thing about how some of these capitalists actually are speaking out against the right, which is an interesting dynamic.
Yeah, absolutely.
That is all the questions I have today. I really appreciate you coming and talking to us. Folks, you've been listening to Professor Roberta Lexier in Calgary, talking with us about the Canadian truckers. We're going to be up next talking with James Hutt in Ottawa about the sort of community mobilization going on there. But it's been great talking with you. Much appreciation.
So great to be here. Thanks so much for giving the opportunity, and solidarity to you and your listeners out there. We're in this global struggle together.
Absolutely. All right. We'll talk to folks in a minute.
Subsidized, privately profitable, the anthem of the opportune puppeteer, untouchable, focus a moment, non-approval, bury your heads in the barcodes of these neo-colonials. Our former nemesis, the romance of a nation-state, now placed the razor for a brand new power concentrate. Try again, but now we're confused. What's class war? Is this class war? Yes, this is class war. And I'm just a kid, I can't believe I gotta worry about this kind of shit. What a stupid world.
Back with Green and Red podcast, talking about the Canadian truckers and what's going on in Ottawa and other points in Canada and points across the border. And now we're speaking with James Hutt, who is based in Ottawa. He's a labor organizer. He organizes with the Canadian Association of University Teachers. And he just penned an article in The Breach called The Battle of Billings Bridge. Welcome to Green and Red, James.
Thank you. Excited to be here.
Yeah. Maybe just kind of like start off, because there's been some developments. This has been a developing week, at least on the government side, around the truckers, which isn't impacting the truckers. But could you actually tell us a little bit about what's going on the ground up in Ottawa today?
Yeah, I mean, it's changing by the minute, by the second. So right now, what the police and different levels of the police and provincial and kind of federal level have done is to create, have cordoned off much of the actual core of the city. It's a really large center of the town has been blocked off and is only accessible by military checkpoints or police checkpoints, I should say. According to reports, there's over 100 checkpoints. And if you do not live or work in the area or have other reason, according to them, to be there, you can be arrested. And this includes media. And we know that the police are starting to make arrests in the area to clear out the convoy supporters. Of some of the figures, the most noxious far-right figures have already left. And then kind of on our end, we've been organizing as a growing coalition of labor unions and community groups and social justice organizations. We're planning to do stuff this weekend. And unfortunately, we've had to kind of postpone that given just this very unprecedented declaration of martial law that's been enacted.
And you, the sort of left-leaning groups were planning like a march or something along those lines?
Yeah, so building on the progress and the momentum we had from last week where we had a march and rally to really get people out into the streets, feeling comfortable again in their own homes, or sorry, in their own streets, being confident in their ability to organize, and then the blockade that happened the next day, tons of people got together, started planning, thinking about how they could do more this weekend, and so everything like last weekend seemed to scale up a few degrees, and we were throwing all efforts towards another big demonstration on the Saturday, and we'd heard there was going to be a number of direct actions happening as well. It looks like, given this very unprecedented legislation, or like actually there is one precedent, the other time that Canada's really declared martial law in history, but given this unique time, it didn't feel safe or appropriate to go ahead with those plans.
Yeah, absolutely. Just a couple of kind of quick background questions. They've been there about 3 weeks at this point, correct?
Yeah, I believe it was January 28th, 29th. So a little more than 3 weeks now.
And what have their numbers looked like? Like how many people have been out there with the Freedom Convoy or what have you?
Yeah, the Freedom for Businesses to Profit Convoy. It's hard to say, honestly. And one of... perhaps it's a very smart tactic on their end. Using these trucks, it makes it seem so much bigger. As someone who's walked around Parliament and on Wellington Street, where most of it is, you have like a dozen, two dozen sort of trucks, 18-wheelers, and it takes up several city blocks. But in there, you might only have a couple dozen people. Numbers tend to swell on the weekends. All the people who can't be there or don't want to camp out there in Canadian winter in February, around the clock, tend to come back or flood in during the weekends. And when I've been walking around there, I would say, you know, middle of the week, evenings, there's 100 to 300 people. On the weekend, it could be 1,000 or up to 3,000.
Not the 50,000, I think I heard in some media sources, which are probably, you know, just right-wing media regurgitation.
I think I saw Fox News say like 13 million, which would be like a third of the population of Canada.
Yeah, there you go. It's a full scale uprising. And how disruptive have they been, either there or in other points in the city?
It's been incredibly disruptive. When you think about just where they are, how they're blocking roads, key arteries in and out of the city, you know, there's been whole areas that ambulances and fire engines just can't get to. And a number of people, especially disabled people, have been in their homes, in their apartments, in that area, and struggling to get around or get groceries. You know, there's kind of this myth that Ottawa downtown is just kind of bureaucrats and office spaces, but there is a large number of people who actually live there. And some of them have been confined in their home, especially seniors living on pensions and government assistance, have been struggling to get out and get groceries. In the times that they do, many are being accosted, threatened for wearing masks. Some have been assaulted. Some have been, you know, attacked. We're hearing all sorts of incidents in which vulnerable populations, Black, Indigenous, racialized people, women, elderly people are being confronted either for wearing masks or attacked. We're hearing them going into stores and overrunning them, anti-maskers overrunning them, harassing staff. We're hearing cases of them threatening and taking food away from homeless shelters. There's been a few incidents of them, some of the supporters actually trying to start fires in apartment buildings with the tenants locked inside. And I think what's happening is that the Convoy supporters, and the worst among them, are kind of pushing against an open door and not facing any resistance. They're getting bolder and bolder and bolder to the point where they're blocking the airport, targeting schools, things like that.
And those, and the folks who are, you know, taking advantage of that are going to be like they would probably fall into like a far right element.
Yeah, I mean, the makeup of the Convoy, and this is kind of an interesting debate that I see playing out across the left in Canada and the US. Some have just said, you know, that this is a genuine working class uprising and we need to support them, which I think is kind of mostly coming from outside Canada, and inside Canada, it's kind of obvious that that's not what's going on.
There's US leftists who have been saying that.
Exactly, yeah. And then within Canada, another kind of the opposite of approach of that is to say, it's all just petit bourgeois, it's all small capitalists, owner operators who can afford to have these trucks and camp out there for weeks and not work, backed by really wealthy donors. And we know that from the Gifts and Go fundraiser, the GoSendMe, a lot of these are very wealthy donors that come from out of country as well. And I think, yes, that's true. It is largely like a small capitalist thing, but they are attracting increasing numbers of the working class to them. And so I've been walking down there. I've been walking down there wearing a keffiyeh, like the sign of Palestinian resistance, and talking to people, and no one has ever commented or said anything about it. And the people I'm talking to have been unemployed since before this, or they are decidedly working class, and are not committed to the far right. You know, but while I'm walking around there, on the big stage, you can hear people putting forward all sorts of right-wing, racist, conspiracy shit. So it's kind of the architects and the organizers and the people in charge of it are these far-right, racist, white supremacist figures, and they're trying to expand their influence.
And that's what they're doing with their megaphones globally, right? It's like, you know, Steve Bannon is like a big right ex-Trump person and big right-wing promoter of causes like this, traveled in Hungary and places like that. It's like all about this. Rand Paul, libertarian right-wing senator, is saying, come on down and let's do this in Washington. And it just seems like it seems very much like, even if it isn't the makeup of the crowd, it's like those figures are like seizing upon this opportunity to like kind of like promote their anti-vax, anti-mandate, right-wing power grab.
Absolutely, yeah.
I'm kind of curious, and Roberta and I talked about this a little bit, but you know, you've been out there in the streets of Ottawa. The reports, and I have no doubt about this because I suspect a percentage of them are actually off-duty police, but how have the Ottawa police responded?
I mean, not at all.
Yeah.
they've shown very clearly that they're not willing to deal with this. They have all the resources, they have all the power they need to deal with it. They did it, they had all that on the first day, and have had ever since, you know. And then the city of Ottawa declared an emergency with some extra powers, then the province did, and now the federal government has as well. And they've sent in the provincial police force, and they could have done anything they wanted to. And every day here in Ottawa, we see images and videos coming out on social media of the police being very jolly with the Convoy supporters, using their vehicles as a sort of a carnival ride, allowing people to get in and pretend to be arrested and take photos, supporting them. There are a number of cases of uniformed police members giving their support on camera, or people out of uniform going down there to support them in their off time.
Yeah, exactly.
And a lot of the key architects of the Convoy are ex-police, ex-military, retired, things like that.
And I saw that, I think this was in the news maybe yesterday or maybe this morning, that one of the main Convoy, the provincial police arrested one of the main Convoy organizers, Tamara Licht or Litch.
Litch, yeah. Yeah, I saw she was arrested, and I saw another one. I'm a bit hesitant to say their names to give them more notoriety, but Pat King, you know, one of these far-right racist figures, he, you know, got the F out of Dodge. He fled and apparently went to a different province as he saw the hammer coming down.
And then the other development this week is that the police chief of Ottawa got sacked this week as a result of this as well.
Yeah. And that's, yeah. I haven't paid too much mind to that because it's kind of just rearranging deck chairs on the Titanic. Whether or not Police Chief Matthew Slowly was really the barrier between the police stopping this or a big influence, I think it's kind of irrelevant. He's operating within a structure, and his position is a role that's going to, you know, protect the interests of the state and the ruling class. Now, there's been people talking about the fact that the police chief is a Black man and he's been taking the fall. And it's probably very likely that he is taking the fall for politicians and others all the way up who don't want to deal with this or wear it as elections come up in the city and province and things like that. But really, no matter who they put in, the police are not going to respond. And I think I really want to emphasize that the convoy is not a threat to the ruling class here in Ottawa or in Canada overall. What they're calling for are things like the ability to shop more and easier, the lifting of mandates and restrictions, all things that help businesses profit compared to the left, which, you know, calling for higher minimum wages, easier rates of unionization, you know, nationalizing industries, all things that actually interfere with the ability of capitalists to profit.
Stopping pipelines.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, I have one last question about sort of some of the on the ground stuff there. Declaring it like a martial law zone. How is that impacting the houseless community in downtown Ottawa or in the city core? You said that even media is not allowed in there. I mean, how's that play out for the homeless?
Yeah, it's hard to know. It's really hard to know because it just happened last night and police have only started to move in this morning, just probably about an hour ago since we began talking. And we don't know. We know that homeless people have been accosted, assaulted, and threatened by the convoy. Many have had been removed from downtown or had their supplies and resources cut off. And when the police have been intervening over the length of this occupation of the city, it has been against people like that, people we know are already vulnerable. And we have to imagine that's what's going to happen here. Because where are homeless populations and unhoused people going to go as the police and different levels of military and government sweep through? It's bad.
Yeah. So it's always an opportunity for them to act like that, to do those things.
Yeah.
To kind of shift gears a little bit, you know, I'm one to ask some questions about how the left has responded. I'd first like to hear about the battle of Billings Bridge. I'd like to hear about like how the Ottawa community like sort of responded to this, at least this past weekend, if not, and I'm sure more than that.
Yeah. I mean, so we are almost on week four now, and for the first week and a half, nothing was happening. And, you know, to an extent, I think the left, unions, labor, generally kind of underestimated it. And perhaps not for good reason, because there's been similar stuff like this in the past few years. There's been like the Yellow Vest version in Canada, which is a far more right-wing thing that happened in France. And then there was actually a trucker convoy called United We Roll about 2 years ago that came into Ottawa, set up, tried to do the exact same thing, but then left, kind of were removed in very short order. So I think people didn't realize just the organization and the staying power of this. And then as things got going, seeing the police not do anything, watching the convoy supporters become far bolder, people were very terrified. There were a couple early attempts to organize a march or rally, and progressive politicians, local groups, municipal organizations came out against it and discouraged people to go because they didn't feel as safe, given the threats, given the level of violence and things like that. And so the organizing before that has mostly been on the level of mutual aid, safety walks, helping people get welfare checks, groceries, things like that. I can't even remember what time it is now. It's been condensed here, but a few days before, maybe 5 days before, I guess a week ago, just over a week ago, a group of like union staffers and activists and rank and file members from unions called a meeting about planning a response to this and actually doing something, because the left has been MIA. The unions haven't done anything. You know, Ottawa is the home to all of the national unions in this country and all the resources and staff, and they haven't done anything they put out statements, which great, you know, statements, cool. That provides some backing. But we organized this and we figured we had to do the first thing was a march and a rally to actually get people out feeling comfortable again and confident in their capacity to organize with one another and feeling like they weren't going to be attacked or injured. And we knew that it would just be an important first step. So we did that. Saturday had a march and rally still quite far away from the occupied area. And even then, a number of unions and politicians came out and were very, like, some actually opposed it, said it was unsafe, others run to. But we went ahead, did it, had extensive training from marshals and legal observers and nonviolent direct action. Our marshals counted about 4,000 people out in the street. In Ottawa, for your listeners, is about 1 million people. And so a really good first step. And the convoy paid us no mind. We were far away. They were dealing with other stuff. And, you know, there were people who criticized us for not going closer to the occupation, and which we understood. But really, it was a exercise in building confidence. And then just hours later that same night, I got a text saying, hey, we're organizing a direct action tomorrow. We're going to block part of this new route of a convoy, supporters coming in with supplies and blocking them. Our plan was to get about 2 to 3 dozen people and block them and make them reroute for 2 hours. We figured, you know, that would be a victory. We couldn't shut down the convoy. We couldn't get rid of them, but this would just be another building success. And then when we got there in the morning, we actually set up in a different location than what's being called the Battle of Billings Bridge, a bit further south in the city. And we found out, as you know, our scouts were reporting around where the convoy was, as we were making preparations, that two other groups of people had set up completely simultaneously and independently of us blockades elsewhere in the city. And one a bit further south on this area of by Billings Bridge on Riverside and Bank was actually more central, so it would hit the convoy more directly and first before it got to us. So we left from ours, went down to reinforce them and got there close to around 50 people at that point and formed a back wall after they'd already blocked in about a number of vehicles so that no more could leave. And we had about 30 vehicles, mostly pickups and SUVs, immobilized there between us. And then when the word got out on social media, people just started showing up from across the city and the numbers ballooned and ballooned and ballooned.
And how many people would you say were there at the height of it?
So at the height of it, I would say close to 2,000 people. Mm-hmm. And mostly the very, you know, not the usual suspects and not political people. When we put the word out, people flooded in. Some of the progressive politicians had asked what we wanted to do, had informed us that the police would escort these vehicles back to the staging ground they had in the east and outskirts of the city. And we were trying to very clearly push us toward that direction, probably out of fear that violence or retribution would happen. And the crowd very flatly and clearly rejected that. And they were not ready to leave. They were not going to be done. And so we decided to dig in and to have fun. I still had the sound system in my car from the rally yesterday in March. So I unloaded it, put on music. People started dancing and we ordered tons of pizzas, put it on more social media. And even more people poured in. And then a little bit later, we'd heard that these far-right figures like Pat King had told their followers on social media to come and confront us. And we knew this very likely meant pretty intense violence. And so myself and a couple of the other organizers, we went through the crowd, held impromptu assemblies, asking people what they wanted out of today, what would victory look like, and to assess their comfort level, to check in with the people that came with and the people around them about the potential risk and what they are willing to take. And then to our surprise, like, I didn't see anyone left. In fact, more showed up. When we put that on social media and then people just started flooding in and it became a massive block party.
That's great. Have there been confrontation? Was there confrontation?
I'm told that Pat King didn't show up and his people. I'm told that he drove by on a parallel road and yelled at us. I don't fully know. I don't know what he looks like really or what car he drives. Maybe a dozen people from the convoy supporters did show up and really tried to start fights, you know, started pushing people, yelling in front of the police. And we were collected and use a lot of the nonviolent direct action and de-escalation training we'd had to shut those people out and diffuse it. And the cops absolutely did nothing. And very clearly we were safe because of the sheer number of people. The fact that people from all walks of life, you know, seniors, racialized people, disabled people came out and turned up in greater and greater number. We were, you know, at the height of 2,000 people around. Mm-hmm. That is what kept us safe, not the police.
Yeah, absolutely. My other question is, you know, with this couple developments that have happened this week with blockades like that, community blockades like that, with the police, the government installing this martial law, I'm kind of curious about some of the left, the kind of institutional left. Do you think that the labor unions or other vestiges of the institutional left, like nonprofits, community groups, et cetera, are actually going to take a little bit further step and lean a little bit more into this? Or do you think it'll just continue to be sort of like public relations, oh, this is bad, press release out every once in a while?
I don't know. This is what really worries me. I have yet to see many actually speak out against the Emergency Measures Act, or originally called the War Measures Act, used to crush the Quebec independence movement in 1970. Really wartime legislation that imposes martial law, takes away rights and freedoms. I have yet to see any real unions come out against it. It's happened very fast. Hopefully some unions will actually at least put out statements and recognize that their members and trade unions will be among the first that this is turned around and used on. But I really haven't. I've seen some people writing about it. I think I've seen the Communist Party here put out it, but I haven't really seen it. And even Canada, we have, of course, a multi-party system. The nominally left party, the New Democratic Party, the Social Democratic Party, has come out in favor of it, which is not entirely surprising, but it is continually disappointing.
They've come out in favor of the Freedom Convoy?
Freedom Convoy. The NDP have come out in favor of the Emergency Act, the War Measures
Act.
Okay.
Sorry. Yeah. That's sad to hear. My last question is, do you see this as on the part of the Freedom Convoy? Do you see this as like a staging or framing? I know that they did something similar in 2019. This seems to be very much an escalation from that. They're definitely taking advantage of all this like anti-vax, anti-mandate sentiment in some quarters out there. But do you see this as like staging for even more escalation, like further down the road?
I think we have to view this as a practice round, like the last were. I mean, people here, it's the largest thing in my mind that has been organized on the far right like this, where in the numbers itself, the stuff that's happening in coordination across the country, blocking the main like bridge from Canada and the US in Windsor, the Ambassador Bridge, causing millions of dollars of economic damage every hour or so, as well as other points of entry from the US. The fact that it's this widespread and this coordinated and this dedicated with large numbers, it means that people are developing networks for organizing, networks for influence and sharing analysis, and that is going to keep pulling people to the far right and their own personal connections. And so we have to think about what happened after this. We have to think about this as a growing extreme right movement that is going to pull in increasing numbers of the working class. And what we've been trying to do here in Ottawa, and I'm hoping others will pick up, is to actually put forward a clear and bold vision for workers. Things like $20 minimum wage, 14 paid sick days for all workers, fixing unemployment, fixing pension plans, nationalizing long-term care, which is still privatized in Canada. All of these things would make, you know, the mandates that the convoy are protesting, they would make them unnecessary. And if we clearly put forward these things, the vast majority of working class people that are being pulled into it will support them. And we know that these extreme right figures will not. And I think that's how we have to clearly articulate that and mobilize for it to create a wedge between this movement.
Absolutely. And that could serve as a model globally, honestly. It's been great talking with you, James. Folks, we've been talking with James Hutt, labor organizer based in Ottawa. You've been listening to the Silky Smooth Sounds of the Green and Red podcast. You can check us out on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. If you're watching this on YouTube, please hit that subscribe button. And then if you haven't already, make a donation at greenandredpodcast.org and hit that support button. We have a new website that's coming up. And then also check us out on Patreon, and you can go to patreon.com/greenandredpodcast, Green and Red Podcast, and become a recurring donor. James, it's been great talking to you today. Really appreciate you coming on. folks stay safe, and but also, you know, misbehave.
We'll try. Thank you for doing this important.